We see Webster defines leadership as the action of leading a group of people or an organization. However, our main man 50 grand, right, by the name of John C. Maxwell, he describes and defines leadership as one word, and that's influence. And so I did like Sandra's version better than John C. Maxwell's, so empowering people, because that's what we do in the military. We train leaders is what we do. And we do that very effectively when we have effective leaders in those key positions, because not everyone is an effective leader, believe it or not, right? And so, you know, you guys see it in society, right? Here in Florida, and I'll just use a quick example. Here in Florida, right, when we talk about politics, right, why do people come to Florida? Why are people moving to the state of Florida in droves? It's because of our good policies. And so good policies equal good environment equals good society. I won't get on my political bandwagon. Let's keep cruising.
Let's get together soon. Okay.
All right. So key number one on becoming an effective leader is very simple. We need to treat people the way we want to be treated. So treat others the way you want to be treated. And actually, Doug, he actually said something very similar, if not the very same thing. And why is that important? Because everyone wants to feel empowered. Everyone wants to be a part of the team, and everyone wants to be respected. 75 countries that I've visited, right? There's one constancy, Tom, one consistency that I noticed and observed. Everyone wants to be respected, no matter what country you're in, no matter what state you're in, no matter what. Everyone wants to be respected. And when we do that and treat them the way they want to be treated and the way you would want to be treated, obviously we can actually get more done. We can become a more productive team. I just want to point out a couple other things. You know, we must be able to trust one another, right? There must be a level of trust, but if I'm respecting you, you're respecting me, we're going to get a lot more done than we would if we're at odds with each other. Now, let's be real. Doug is the owner of Woodchuck, right? So while he gets the final say-so, ultimately, he would be deceived if he did not at least listen and take input from those that work on his team. Correct, Doug?
Absolutely.
So we had a CT scanner. I'll just give you a quick example of this. That we needed in the OR. And I think this is what you're referring to, Tom.
We
talked about
effectiveness.
So we had a sailor, a junior sailor, was a supply representative that worked in the OR. Well, this OR technician needed a CT scanner in the OR to be able to provide patient care to a patient on Monday. Well, it's Friday, and what usually happens on Fridays around 3 or 4 p.m.? Yeah, everybody's ready to go home. So, as a good leader, I secured my team, allowed them to basically go home early for the weekend, enjoy your families, enjoy your lives. So it's just myself and one junior staff member and this OR technician. And they say to me, Commander, we really need that CT scanner in the OR because we're not going to be able to fulfill our patient care mission on Monday if we don't have it. Well, so the first thing I do is I look at the piece of equipment to make sure it's been safety checked. And we know that our biomedical repairmen, they make sure that there's a green sticker on that piece of equipment and that it's actually dated, right, with the right time frame, because you don't want to use a piece of equipment out of date either. So Commander Brown and one of the junior staff members, we put this bad boy on the truck and delivered it to the hospital. If I can't do the same job that this person does at the junior level, then how effective am I? Now, I've done those things before, but if my pride got in the way, Tom, we would have not been able to take care of our patients in the hospital that Monday. So, bottom line is, I treated the supply rep or the supply technician the very same way I would have wanted to have been treated if I was the supply rep. Does that make sense?
Yes.
All right, so you've got that point. Number two. And I'm going to save this for last.
Number two.
I know, but I think I want to do something different, Tom. Number two, of becoming an effective leader. We need to provide necessary resources, right, which includes funding, manpower, training, tools, and equipment to increase our team success. If there's one thing that a sailor, an airman, a soldier, and a Marine hates the most, it's not having the resources they need to accomplish the mission, right? I mean, I think that's a given. Wouldn't you say, Doug?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Anybody.
Yes, but you know, Bill, you would be amazed. People who are in business don't take on something as simple as that principle and apply it in the organization. They'll forget about it because here's what they've done. They say to the supervisor, you take care of it. And they never think about these things, right? But it's important, even at the tip of the spear, you need to be connected with the organization and the people.
As a leader, if you haven't put the time to plan and then put the plan in action to equip, you can't expect.
It's true. Even the great Benjamin Franklin once said that failure to prepare is preparation to failure. People do not plan to fail. They simply fail to plan. Mm-hmm. That's the bottom line.
We're talking about dumpsters and cardboard crushers.
Yeah, right.
I mean, the most basic example. Yeah, but it's simple.
It is.
Equipping.
That's right. So, bottom line is, I'm not going to go through all of the little bullets here. You can, we'll get them a copy of the presentation, Tom.
Yeah,
okay. Number, where are we at? Number three?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm becoming an effective leader. Three key words here. Exercise effective communication. And I heard Doug talk about this again this morning. I've been thinking to myself, man, this guy's been all in my presentation.
You know? I sent him an early copy.
Did you really?
All right. I needed some content. I said, well, I don't know what to do. He said, just do this. Like, thank you. I know you do that too. It's kind of awkward.
It's awkward. Exercise effective communication. And here's what I love, right? And this is a principle that the Holy Spirit actually gave me. He said, Willie, you must learn to listen in order that you might listen to learn. There is absolutely no way to be an effective communicator until you learn to listen first. And then once you learn to listen, you can actually listen to learn. It sounds like an oxymoron, doesn't it? But it's a very important lesson that the Holy Spirit taught me. And let's be honest, when someone's talking, it's rude to talk while they're talking, right? A little communication etiquette, right? In the wardroom, on in the chief's mess, wherever we were at as leaders, we would never cut the other person off while they were communicating. Why? Because what they had to say was important to us. And that's how we have to treat each other. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So, bottom line up front. You've already got the answer to that one. Exercise was the fill-in for that one. The bottom line up front means bluff. We need to listen more than we talk.
Yes.
Right? And obviously, don't talk when other people are talking because that's very rude. And one of my little punchlines I love, Tom, is a short pencil is better than a long-term memory. So we need to learn to write things down. Right?
That's good.
I like that.
Can I get an amen?
Amen.
All right. Number four, on becoming an effective leader, we need to learn how to walk with humility and teachability, right? We must walk with humility and teachability. And why is that important? Because we know what pride does. It destroys, it's destructive, it's distractive, it divides. There can absolutely be no effectiveness, right, when pride is in the way. So we need to remain humble, humility. And God's been teaching me more about humility as well and teachability in the Proverbs. I've been loving it, man. I've been really enjoying the Proverbs here lately.
He taught me that in the streets.
Is that right?
Let me get this pretty.
But think about this, though. When you're on a team, just because you know the answer doesn't necessarily mean that you have to say something. See, humility teaches us that, you know what? I don't have to shine all the time, right? How about let's let someone else shine, right? Because the focus is on the organization at large, not one person, right? Unfortunately, you know, we have to have somebody who owns the business and who actually does give some watching orders in terms of leadership, but humility says, you know what? Let's find someone else that we can help and elevate and make them feel extra special, right? Teachability, right? I don't know everything, right? No one knows everything, but here's what I have learned. When I learn to listen, and I listen to learn, I'm able to hear what other team members have to say that actually elevates the organization to the next level. And I'll give you my story about the junior officer who had an invention for a field x-ray unit, right? So the supervisor brings this junior sailor into my office and he begins to talk to me. He says, Commander Brown, I have an idea that I think will help us to save some money, right? And his idea was, and if you guys understand what combat operations, if you have an idea of what it looks like on a combat field, I was in Iraq, right, for a year, and I saw temperatures in the heat up to 138 degrees Fahrenheit. That's hot. And if hell is hotter, I don't even want to be close to it, right? But this kid, he says to me, he says, sir, I've designed a mechanism that will allow us to utilize these field x-ray units far longer than we've been using them in the past. Because what was happening was we had to take them out of service because they were overheating, right? And he designed and developed a mechanism that allowed us to use our field x-ray units far longer than we could have ever used them in time past. So we took his idea. He ended up saving the Department of the Navy alone, not even the other service organization, but the Department of the Navy alone, $18 million. $18 million, right? Because we were frying the other ones, they were overheating, and we had to replace them. But the docs, they needed them in the field. And so you'll like this, Dean. So we obviously meritoriously promoted this kid, and then we also gave him a lump sum payment of a lot of money. I won't say what it was, but he was able to go buy him a new Toyota Tundra. Let's just put it that way. So the Bureau of Medicine, they took this idea and they forwarded it to the Pentagon. And so the Department of Defense said, you know what? Let's implement this into the Air Force and the Army. And so now the Air Force and Army also save millions of dollars on field units because they too deploy in the fields. And so this one kid's idea, if I didn't have any humility, right, and I had this I-know-it-all attitude, we would have missed an opportunity. Mm-hmm. That's all I'm saying. That's the whole point.